Hey, it is your buddy, Peace and Harmony, with you here today. Much love going out to all the beautiful, empowered harmonizers. We are zooming in and focusing in on a great viewer question, and that is how to get released sort of from the confusion and sort of the loss of direction that she feels as a result of a relationship with a covert narcissist. This sort of feeling of being listless, of being able to be sort of feeling shut down, feeling lost without direction is a real key sort of red flag that you might feel within if you're in a relationship with a covert narcissist. This is really known as cognitive dissonance. A covert narcissist will create a stage or a feeling or an atmosphere known as cognitive dissonance. It's a very sort of specific and precise sort of tension, psychological tension and stress and discomfort that is created in the target or supply. Cognitive dissonance means it's not computing. What they say and what they do does not match, yet they're demanding to the contrary or to the opposite. In other words, an adherence as if they are the provider, the caregiver, the one who's taking, they're requiring a compliance to a loyalty or a commitment or a marriage or a sibling or a work partner, but yet they're sort of letting the bottom drop out and they're unassailable and unable to have this sort of experience discussed with them. It creates a cognitive dissonance, which is a very peculiar feeling that a lot of people feel as, anxiety producing. Because there's a feeling that it might not ever be resolved. It's like a constant sort of looming over with a covert narcissist. Kind of like a perpetual dark cloud or stormy mass that sort of might just sort of fill the relationship or the atmosphere. But yet, you might just not know what direction, though, to go and lighten it up. So it will feel like a chronic and ongoing feeling. Cognitive dissonance, is an important understanding to move through. It's an important term or concept to grasp. Cognitive dissonance was you're in a very, really exquisite sort of pain, meaning, and this pain can be addictive for a lot of people. Their body can start to crave this as a new normal for them. So you have to be careful because that will create an I am or an identity, known as codependence or enabling with a psychopath or, I'm sorry, a covert narcissist. Where you don't realize these dynamics that you're sort of wedging yourself into, and you didn't realize that you were kind of going down, the quicksand, and that you were getting into this dynamic with a covert narcissist, which they unfledgingly, they always want to have the I'm above and you're below, and they don't want to give credit for any credit that's due so that you could be on the level or have just sort of a straightforward two-directional discussion or communication. There's always sort of a cognitive dissonance that is created, meaning, I'm here for you, but they're not. I am your confidant, but you can't share anything with me. This exquisite, sort of I am to be relied on, but I'm never emotionally present. These sort of it's just very oxymoron, if you will. So it does it creates a very exquisite tension, pain, or stress that will throw one's body off of homeostasis, meaning out of balance. You might be cold, hot, anxious, not able to sleep, unable to wake up. I mean, or you might feel like you want to hide or you want to run away. All these sort of extremes are a real indicator that you're experiencing this, which is known as cognitive dissonance. And with a covert narcissist, they will keep that sort of allow to be cycle in their supply. They will allow, they basically just say, you know what? If the supply doesn't figure it out, that's their problem. If I've taken advantage of them, if I've taken advantage of their vulnerability and they can't do anything about it, that's their problem. It's sort of, yeah, but they then are trying to demand respect as a narcissist does, which is a very sort of superficial respect, maybe respect where respect isn't due. they're just sort of an empty, vapid, or meaningless show of respect. Otherwise, gratuitous, with a covert narcissist, it's very difficult to have that sort of depth and richness of a relationship because oftentimes, because they're sort of devoid of empathy, they're not able to have that exchange. So you'll feel maybe that something is missing and unable to be resolved, so you can stay in that state for quite a period of time. So be very careful that you don't get stuck and mired in this. It can, perpetuate a sort of a trauma bond and perpetuate a vulnerability in your identity, which becomes sort of, it can become feeling weaker and weaker with time, or more and more insecure with time, or sort of more and more stressed, if you will, which is an indicator really that things are out of balance with either how things are, how things were, or just sort of moving forward. It can be very specific in where that lack of understanding is, or it can be in all places, in all areas of the relationship, or could have just started maybe a devaluing, stage. It's very important to understand, that there's going to be a certain degree of superficiality in a relationship with a covert narcissist. It's not going to be able to hold water. It's not going to be able to hold its salt. It might not be able to hold a lot of sort of going through ups and downs together. That feeling of togetherness, you and me against the world. If it is, it might be very superficial, vapid, or sort of come and go very quickly. Meaning it doesn't really take root or substance or become really substantial. A narcissist is very good at warding off substantial, meaningful talk. They are very aloof, meaning just they're just sort of exit stage left. They'll find whatever Houdini trap door that they can sort of escape in. It might be the garage, the attic, the neighbors. They're always working. They might become like a workaholic, always sort of unavailable, or just keeping, crazy schedules, and just sort of remaining aloof and distant, emotionally distant, yet requiring just sort of this unquestionable allegiance to them. It creates a cognitive dissonance, a very, once again, very difficult sort of heavy, feeling oftentimes that people feel like it can feel like a deer in a headlight, just kind of like you're up against it because you might realize, that you can't really rely on them to clear the air. And it becomes very difficult then for you to clear the air on your own and come to terms when maybe a lot of the feelings are surrounding the relationship itself. So it's like it becomes a very dead end relationship, especially when you have a lot of momentum going forward. It can create a real exquisite problem because you have a vision of the future together. So a lot of people, with a covert narcissist, they are sort of emptying themselves to, then it oftentimes creates a real, commonly it will create a codependency where that person has to unfailingly replace their own needs with a priority of fulfilling the other's needs. What would be, they're always asking what would be good for them? What would, make them look good? They're the easy one to uplift and support. So you might find that you're very, very supportive of these individuals, always thinking about their needs and that they're the one to work on. They're the one to put together. They're the one to ego stroke. Meanwhile, you won't be getting this in return. And a lot of people have, I would say, the erroneous thought that they think that eventually it might be returned. But then, if it doesn't get returned for days, weeks, months, years, or decades, then people get kind of mystified and then they retain this cognitive dissonance. What went wrong? What did I do wrong? I thought I was doing everything right. Like, it's just a complete, twisting and contorting and oftentimes a perverting of anxiety. I mean, where it just doesn't seem to work itself out. You feel that you're running in circles, running in knots, running in pretzels, whatever it is, it becomes very difficult to feel that you can sort of undo the ball of twine that it sort of creates. And the cognitive dissonance needs to be resolved and worked through, meaning understanding, and having a and looking at things with a rigorous honesty and being able to confront the relationship as it is with new information, that this is not gonna be developing and taking me to the place that I want to be. So this a lesson is truly for you when you sort of untangle a lot of the directions and start getting the direction right, especially as is what is known in Buddhism, I think, is like the right path. But in other words, so you can be square on with yourself and have a square forward-looking vision for your future, you oftentimes need to clear out the misunderstanding that was developed by means, developed in the relationship with this individual. Meaning, there might have been some taking advantage of. You gave too much. You sacrificed a lot. You sacrificed it all. You were always trying to do good by them. What were your marching orders? And to what degree were you not, equally, as if, or if not more important? And if so, and why did this get out of balance? Why did you have to suffer and they win? Why did you have to take it all on, do all the work, remain quiet-lipped and sort of, stay in that state in order to pay the price for the relationship, to keep it going, to maintain it, to keep it present, to keep it at least going somewhere. So it can be very trauma bonding. If you trauma bonding, meaning you're sort of creating and re-injuring the wound again and again, and then the wound becomes very pronounced. It can become very open. It's unhealed. It's still actively being hurt. So you need to sort of back off when you're in a cognitive dissonant state, meaning this does not feel right. Something is awry. I'm upset and my partner is laughing. They're doing well and I'm doing miserable. I've sacrificed and I'm not getting anything in return. I've taken care of their needs. I've let them know that they're number one, and as far they treat me like I'm number zero. They disrespect me even though I've done all this. It's a cognitive dissonant state. So these are questions, but you'll stay in a cognitive dissonant state if you just keep asking the same questions and don't arrive at a pause and an observation about the mixed messages and the tug, of direction, and what is the proper tug of direction, and to what degree are you keeping a wrong direction going? In other words, are you trying to, is there a degree of enmeshment going on where there's too many blurred boundaries and you're not independent and autonomous enough? So there's either a leaning on them or them leaning on you, otherwise known as enabling. This can perpetuate cognitive dissonance as well. So being able to understand your own position, which might be hurtful, it might be difficult to admit, it might be make you embarrassed, feel small, meek, weak, cry, think it's never going to work out, it can never change. These are just, thoughts of limiting self-belief. So when you come through cognitive dissonance, you really have to make sure that you don't have a lot of, self-limiting beliefs that have been developed and entertained by the covert narcissist, because a narcissist, will continue to harbor people living in their own, very small self-limiting beliefs, and then say, you're not good enough or whatever, and they're very good at the blame shifting, so it perpetuates the cognitive dissonance and pushes it even deeper. So it's very important that you understand a little bit about what codependency is and if this lives within you. And if so, to what degree is it having a negative or deleterious effect? Meaning, to what degree are you not, valuing yourself, and you're putting a value of another in front of yourself, really is what codependency is. You're not valuing yourself, you're always valuing another, you're always putting another first. At first, it might have been in the name of love, the polite thing to do, the right thing to do. This person needed my support. They needed my help. It appeared to me they were suffering. It appeared to me they needed me. I was sensitive to their needs. I love them. Determining on the type of love that this person is in your relationship. It might be familial, it might be sibling, it might be a colleague respect, it might be romantic love. It's unique for each individual. But it's to understand that, a covert narcissist oftentimes will create form and reinforce. In other words, reinforce, give reward for supply behavior. So a covert narcissist will sort of reward supply and target behavior when you give them whatever it is that they need. And if you're not challenging them, causing them to do a lot of work, communicate so they can continue to remain aloof, fade off into the woodwork, fade off into the sunset, ride off into the distance, wherever it is that they want to gallivant and ride away to, they're going to be untouchable. You're going to feel that you're always sort of they're out of your reach. That's the problem with the covert narcissist, that they always just, their lack of communication and lack of emotional sort of ability, it always feels like discussion with them is out of reach, but yet you feel a compulsion to satisfy that tension of cognitive dissonance. And through oftentimes the relationship, which oftentimes aggravates it for you or makes it worse. So that's why it's so important to go no contact. And to really take a look at things, because if it's taking you in the wrong direction, it's okay to say, holy guacamole, it's taking me in the wrong direction. And, as I always say, what would my future self like for me to do in this situation? Do you want to stay down and out, in the root cellar, in, the bottom of the bottom, of the low of the low? I mean, how low do you want to be feeling? What is your choice? And look at this crossroads as an opportunity to say, what would my future me want for me to do right now? How would I handle this with grace and ease and wisdom and emotional intelligence and hold up my head high? What would my future me like for me to do? And you can ask yourself that, because then you're also looking forward. And you really need to be able to look forward to kind of extract yourself from a cognitive dissonant state. It's going to take some time, but you do need to understand how it feels like, the cause that creates the effect, and then being able to, sort of get outside of yourself and say, how do I want to handle this? Do I want to handle this like a 2-year-old, lying on the floor, pounding and screaming and throwing a tantrum? Do I want to be like those people on Jerry Springer, throwing the chairs around, yelling, and we've got three people, jumping off the stage and making a scene? Do I want that to be me? Do I want the police to be involved? Do I want courts to be involved? Does the future me want to make a big deal of this? How, and so you can say, and so I think that's a very important vision. Do I want to end up here? Do I want to end up, miserable, sad, alone, in a corner, not enjoying life? Or would future me say, gosh darn it, I'm gonna enjoy life. Period, end of story. Enough is enough. Time is your most important commodity, and you have to look at where you're at in life. And if you think there'll be a lot of tomorrows, and you better. I think in healing, you really, come to a term, when you really begin to heal, you really begin to value and respect your own time. And what that means for you, and that is something, you can't get back. And so to spend a lot of your time suffering, I mean, sure, there's legitimate and real suffering where it has to be done, and there are lessons to be learned from it. I mean, that's the pain is there to give a message. A lesson to be learned. What is your takeaway from this? Will help you to articulate and understand what is my takeaway from the pain, and to what degree, Am I, is there a payoff from the pain? In other words, what degree, if you're still in, am I still, so you have to ask yourself if you're staying in a cognitive dissonant state for a long period of time and in a lot of emotional pain, and it's going on and on and on for weeks, it's interfering with your personal life, everything about your routine, your sleeping, your eating, your habits, you don't like how things are going in your life, you're fearful, you're feeling too many ups and downs. It's just, too wild is the wind, for your emotions right now. Then you need to say, to what degree do I want to live my life in this turmoil? To what degree do I want to live like this? And you need to have those, questionable, questioning moments for yourself to kind of help snap yourself out of a cognitive dissonant state and realize and put yourself into focus that you are number one. You are what is important. When you're in a relationship with a covert narcissist, oftentimes you're operating under the pretense in the relationship that they are, air quotes, the important one. They are, quote unquote, the one in the relationship. They are the number one, and I am a number two. When you begin, taking names and tickets, like you're at a deli counter. I'm number one, I'm number two, I'm number three. You have to be very, very careful if you're not putting yourself as number one within you. I mean, you have to realize that that is very, very important. The covert narcissist will try to disorder that and surely sort of shelter you from that experience of autonomy, strength, because they are so distant, aloof, indifferent. I would just say very non-communicative, of very few words, of very perhaps even shallow emotions, which don't have a full spectrum. They might range from narcissistic rage to sort of very egoic infatuation. Where they're really only interested in themselves, they're not interested in others. Pathological sense of self-importance is what is going on. This leads to entitlement, this leads to grandiosity, and also it creates a lot of cognitive dissonance in relationships with others. So you, and if your relationship has fostered a dependency or a codependency, is to say, to what degree does my future self want me to remain in this? To what degree is this healthy, what I call sustainable? It might be have been a phase, but it's something that you might need and want to grow out of sooner than later, because oftentimes that will put you in a very powerless and helpless position, powerless and helplessness, which is part of the cognitive dissonance after effects. So you have to ask yourself these questions and then see what your decision is. And then when you say, no, I would rather be, and then what is your rather be? What is your 1 through 20 today? What would you rather be? Write that down. Be, feel, have, do, become, what it looks like, what it feels like, where I'm going, where things are going, the relationship, the family, where you live, what you're doing, where you're at mature wise, like what is for future you gonna thank you for? Future me, thank you. You have to ask yourself that and get in touch with that because that can be a real life-saving question. It'll help really put things into perspective, and then you'll own that decision. When you own the decision, it's yours. No one can take it away from you. And that's pretty much a good part of empowerment for you. This is your buddy, peace and harmony with you here today. I hope these videos do help. Please share, please subscribe, and please donate for more great tools, videos, discussions, and support. Peace be with you. Peace, peace, peace. Have a beautiful day.